Fourth relates to what? Emotive? Emotions. Feeling. Yeah. So this would be thinking, feeling, wouldn't it?
Okay.
All right. This is also referred to as RET. This is a secular theory, but it, I think that gives us a little bit of a background.
Sure.
A little bit of a foundation. And here is the basic premise of RET therapy. This is the cognitive therapy. This is activating event. Now usually you think in terms of, you remember in psychology you had your SR combination, meaning the stimulus will elicit a certain response. Okay. If you hit somebody, that's a stimulus, and they're going to act with shock, or they're going to draw back their fist. In other words, you're going to respond to some stimulus, right?
Yep.
All right, here is your stimulus. This is your response. This is what we call the activating event. This is the event that takes place, but it does not necessarily lead to a specific consequence. Because intervening here between the activating event and the consequence is what you believe about it. Question. Could the same thing happen, the same event happen, that would affect two different people? Say siblings. Brother and sister, sisters. The same event happened. Say the divorce of their parents. Okay, what do you think would be one of the consequences of divorce of the parents? Here's the event, divorce of the parents, and what would be some consequences? What would be some feelings? This is the activating event, and this would be the consequences or the feelings. Keep in mind, this is rational emotive. What would be some consequences of the divorce of parents as far as affecting the siblings, the children?
Unhappiness.
What about sadness?
Sadness, yeah.
Unhappiness.
Yes.
Anxiety. Anger.
Anger.
There are a lot of emotions that can be elicited from the event of divorce.
Sure.
But what is going to determine what that consequence is what each thinks about it.
That's right.
Okay? So this is the whole basis of cognitive therapy, is what you think about an event. Okay? Now, again, let me say that the basis of cognition, or the basis of cognitive therapy, is how you think determines how you feel and how you behave. Distortion of thinking needs to be challenged and redirected into rational thoughts. And we will get, I'll give an example of irrational thoughts. Let's let me give you an example. Let's say the event is being fired on your job.
Okay.
One person would react how?
Mad, give up.
Anger, depression. Relieved.
Mm-hmm.
So what is going to determine what your response is again?
How you think about it.
What you think about it, your belief. Now, what you want to do in therapy, in counseling, is to challenge irrational thoughts, because irrational thoughts can lead to wrong feelings.
That's right.
If you have the wrong thoughts. Here would be the activating event, would be getting fired on the job. This is the activating event, fired. An irrational thought would be, I am a failure. Okay? Which would lead to a possible Feeling of what?
Give up.
Give up. Depressed.
Depressed.
Afraid.
Fear. Okay, there are a lot of emotions, right? Mm-hmm. So, now, if, say, for example, if you have a right attitude here, your belief is probably, I'll get another job.
A better job.
A better job. Okay? And that would lead to a different feeling, would it not?
Exactly right.
And so what you want to do in counseling is to challenge these irrational thoughts. And these irrational thoughts are usually associated with an all or nothing attitude. You see yourself as either a total failure or, you know, success. Should, I ought. I am a failure. Another irrational thought would be, I'll never get another job like this. Would that be irrational? It could be. And all right, there could be some basis for it. But when you just totally give up and you basically see yourself as being a total failure, let's say the event is you make a V. Your rational thought would be, my parents will never love me again, or I am a failure. You can say again here, I am a failure. Which would lead, of course, to, again, feelings of sadness, depression. Now, is there anything wrong with making a B?
No.
And see, what happens oftentimes is that the pressure is put on a person because they have such unrealistic expectations. They have unrealistic goals. And so you want to challenge those irrational beliefs and those irrational thoughts. So that's really the basis of cognitive therapy. Let me give you four basic types of cognitive errors. Four basic types of cognitive errors that can lead to a client's misery. Four types of cognitive errors. First error is what we call selectively perceiving something negatively. Perceiving negative features. Now, what do we mean by selectively perceiving? What do we mean by selective perceiving?
When you perceive a setting, a particular.
When you're zeroing in on a particular point at the exclusion of all others.
That's right.
You've ever heard the term selective forgetting? A child who selectively forgets,
they
forget what they really, down deep inside, don't really want to do. Mm-hmm. And so if the parent comes back and says, you didn't do thus and so, the child will come back and say, I forgot. Mm-hmm. But they selectively forget certain things because I will assure you they will remember the things they want to remember.
That's right.
Okay, so selectively perceiving negative features at the exclusion of zeroing in or focusing on the positive things. That is an error. A second cognitive error is overgeneralization. These could make some wonderful test questions.
Mm-hmm.
Overgeneralization. Now, what do we mean by generalizing? What do we mean by generalization? When you generalize something, What would be an example of generalizing?
Thinking up an example.
Okay, when you generalize something, you make it universal.
Yes.
You take a specific event, mm-hmm. so you observe one specific event, and then you make an all-encompassing general statement. For example, you take a specific case, you can take a specific case and make it a B, and then you generalize, and you say, no, that wouldn't be a good example of generalization.
Like here all men are bad.
What's that?
All men are bad.
Exactly. Yeah,
that's
okay, you have one bad experience.
That's right.
A specific event, and you come to the general conclusion that all men are bad.
That's
very
right.
Good. Okay. The third error is, another example would be being rejected for a job. That would be one specific event, mm-hmm. and then concluding that no one will hire you.
Sure.
Yeah, you being rejected for a date. You ask someone for a date, they reject you. And you say, nobody will ever ask me out. A third error is magnifying. That's making a mountain out of a molehill.
Mm-hmm.
Making things bigger than they really are.
You spelled that.
Yeah, it's M.
Magnifying. Very good. Magnifying. Making a mountain out of a molehill. Overestimating the importance of something.
Exactly right.
A fourth error is absolutist thinking. And this would be, again, it's all or nothing. Unless I write the best exam they've ever seen, I'm a failure as a student. This is when it's perfectionistic,
mm-hmm.
that you say that if I'm not perfect, I'm a failure.
Oh.
Or if you say that it's necessary for someone, for everybody to love me. Now that's irrational, isn't it? If a person doesn't like me, that means I'm unlovable. Okay. So what you have to do, of course, as a counselor, is to make a distinction between rational thinking and irrational thinking. Automatic thoughts are reactions sometimes without even being conscious. You react in a certain way to thoughts that will cause you to respond in a certain way without even thinking about it. And of course, one of the tasks of counselors would be to help the client to recognize automatic thoughts, to call their attention to it, because awareness is a big part of dealing with irrational thoughts. We may not even be aware that we're being irrational. We have to,
that's right.
As a counselor, we have to challenge those irrational thoughts and ideas. Okay, let's take a quick overview now of our textbook, the chapter. We have six major categories, six major subtitles, subsections. And this is pretty much the way the remainder of the class is going to go on this lesson. First, we'll be taking a look at guidelines for changing partner's cognition. Guidelines for changing a partner's cognition. The second is teaching the cognitive paradigm. I'll give an explanation for each of these after we give you the overview. We'll get into more details.
Okay.
The third subsection is reducing negative thinking. Reducing negative thinking. The fourth subsection is changing attributions of blame. Changing attributions of blame. And that just basically says that it would be irrational for one partner to always blame the other partner. They're attributing blame. to the partner. And then, of course, when you change the attribution of blame, that is helping one to see that they're also responsible and they need to take their share of the blame. Number five is changing negative expectations about the marriage. Changing negative expectations. Number six is changing negative assumptions about the marriage. So as you can see, these are all topics which should help us as counselors to arm ourselves with interventions which can be very helpful in improving the marriage, helping to make the marriage more successful. Now, in this particular lesson, we have a relatively small number of, let's see. Okay, I kind of, how many pages do you have on your outline? Your pages, three?
Three.
Oh, okay. So you do have those, you do have those things that I discuss in the introduction, do you not?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Under cognitive therapy? Do you have that on your? Okay. All right. Now here we have seven interventions. Seven interventions. I think every one of these are excellent. Now keep in mind that it would really be near impossible for us in one class time to be able to teach everything that is in this chapter and for you to grasp hold of it and to understand it completely. But I'm introducing you to these, and then again, you use your textbook as a resource to go back to, as a reference. But here are the interventions that we're going to be looking at tonight. Number one is increasing the spouse's awareness of their selective attention to negative behavior. You see up here, we said that selective attention to negative behavior is one of the irrational cognitive errors, right? And so we want to intervene by increasing the spouse's awareness of their selective attention to negative behavior. And then the second intervention is a homework assignment. And this is to have the partners to monitor their negative thoughts for a week. I dealt with a student here last week that really was demonstrating some negative thinking about his own self-esteem, and I was able to help him. And I said, you know, of course, one of the things is to be aware of these thoughts, and that can be done through monitoring. We'll talk more about that. Number three is changing. Now, number two is monitoring negative thoughts. Number three is changing negative thoughts. It's one thing to monitor your negative thoughts, and then it's another thing to change those negative thoughts. Yep. Number four is a homework assignment of keeping a journal of marital improvements. Keeping a journal of marital improvements. Number five is a homework assignment. You have partners change negative thinking. Now, that would tie in pretty much with number three. It says changing each partner's negative thoughts. But this is a homework assignment where they can work outside of the counseling session. Number six is a homework assignment, identifying faulty assumptions about marriage and changing them. And I think you'll find these to be very simple to understand, and probably will see that they can be very helpful. Then number seven is dealing with your all-encompassing statements, your universal statements of always, never, and everyone. Have you ever had someone say, you never do so-and-so? Mm-hmm. And all you had to do to refute that is say, well, now you remember last month I did something, so that kind of debunks the idea that you never. Mm-hmm. And they'll come back and they'll say, oh, you know what I mean. Or you say you always, and you call to attention one example where you didn't. You know, so we're going to deal with these all-encompassing universal statements. Now let's look more specifically at our subsections. Look first at the guidelines for changing cognition. Guidelines for changing cognition.
The first thing that we want to do is to teach the counselees what we call the cognitive paradigm. Now, this is not anything elaborate. It's not anything fanciful. It's just a very simple paradigm. And the paradigm is made up of two parts. One is the general and the specific. There are general statements that you can make, but then you have to make those personal. You have to make those specific to your situation. Now, here is the second part of that paradigm. It's based on two truths. Number one is that cognition causes maladaptive behavior and feelings, not external events or people. Let me repeat that. Cognition causes maladaptive behavior and feelings, not events. In other words, it's an inside job. Mm-hmm. Your maladaptive behavior, the way you behave that may be maladaptive, is not based on what someone does to you, but it's based on what you think about it. And the second truth is that changing cognition will change behavior and feelings. You got those two principles. Number one is that maladaptive behavior is not caused by some external event or a person. Nobody can make you mad.
True.
Do you understand that?
You choose to.
See, maladaptive behavior would be to demonstrate anger, right? To lose control. Now, losing control is not caused by what someone did to you or even what someone said about you. But it's how you perceived it, how you thought about it, the way you reacted to it.
Yes.
Okay. And so if we can change the way we think about something, then that will lead to a change in behavior and feelings. You have a grasp now? Mm-hmm. That would be a good little essay question. You could ask to give a brief explanation or give a very brief basis as to what you mean by cognitive therapy. It's based on challenging irrational thoughts, which will lead to a change in feelings and behavior. So before you can change someone's thinking, you have to explain to them these basic principles of the cognitive paradigm. Second guideline is we change cognition by changing specific cognition. In other words, the first is the general. Those are general principles, general statements. Now, you can change cognition by dealing with a specific event or a specific example, a specific thought. In the beginning, you can question a couple's homework. For example, when they come back with their homework, you could take a look and you can ask them, what do you think led to your success or failure on this homework assignment? Mm-hmm. If the assignment is not successful, you question the cognitive factors that might have been involved. What were your thoughts? What were you thinking that could have led to your failure? Number three is when, this is again a guideline, when dealing with a particular belief, thought, expectation, or assumption, follow a set procedure. And this procedure is determine the content of the cognition. You can't deal with whether something is rational or irrational until you focus in on the actual content. The content could be the statement, happy married people never have disagreements. Is that a rational statement or irrational?
Irrational.
It's irrational. So you would have to take a look at and call attention to that specific content. Happy married people never have disagreements. Then, of course, what you would want to do here would be to point out that very successful marriages have had their problems, and it has not destroyed their relationship. Then you ask how this particular thought that you have affects your marriage, either positively or negatively. And then here's what you want to do. When you challenge someone on an irrational thought or belief, you want to present evidence that will either support that thought or that will refute it. So if you say to a person, now let's take a look at the statement you just made. Happy married people never have disagreements. Now what you're going to have to do as a counselor, if you think that's an irrational statement, is to give evidence to refute that statement. On the other hand, if that counselee continues to believe that's a rational statement, then they need to come up with evidence.
That's right.
That would support their contention that it is a true statement. Okay. The fourth guideline is correcting couples with poor actions and cognition. Now, this can be something that you have to be very careful about. And I'm going to give you an example. And this is, you have to be very careful about continuously pointing out the failures that a person has, or just continuously pointing out the negative. If you continually zero in on the negative things that people say, everything that comes out of their mouth, they'll get discouraged. Okay. Now back 20 years ago or so, there was a teaching in the body of Christ that was very strong concerning confession of your mouth, that it's important what comes out of your mouth. And I still believe that is a very strong, definite truth. That's a principle that is very true. One of the things that I discovered then was that people were getting in the habit of bringing to someone's attention every time they said something negative. Now, it's one thing to make yourself accountable to someone and say, I want you to remind me anytime that something comes out of my mouth, or remind me of some action that would be detrimental. I'm going to make myself accountable to you. But it's another thing when people become self-appointed guardians over what you say, and they continuously point out your negative speech, your negative confession. Now, in a counseling session, it would be very helpful for the counselor to remind someone and say, now I want you to think about what you just said. I want you to think about this assumption. I want you to think about the statement that you just made. So you continuously bring to their attention, and then you discuss it. Now, again, I think that if we haven't learned anything in this course other than the fact that there is a very strong emphasis on accentuating the positive rather than the negative, I think that we will leave here with a very good principle. That we need to learn how to accentuate the positive. We need to learn how to see the best in our spouses rather than the worst.
Yeah.
Okay, number five is change cognition to focus on love, work, and faith. So if the cognition is negative, if the cognition is irrational, and you turn that around to focus on love, work, and faith, which produces hope, which produces a successful marriage, then that would be turning the negative into the positive. There's nothing any more positive than love, faith, and work. All right. You help partners to avoid blaming each other by getting them to think in terms of being responsible for their own behavior and how they can improve it. The next subsection, and we have pretty much, I think, have already covered this as much as we need to. This is teaching the cognitive paradigm. Again, the cognitive paradigm is based on the general, the specific, and the two truths that cognition affects the way you think and feel. I'm sorry, the way you feel and behave. And by changing thinking, changing the cognition, will lead to the changes in feeling and behavior. All right, the next subsection that we're going to be looking at is reducing negative thinking. Reducing negative thinking. Now, here's what's going to happen. This, again, is a reoccurring theme. This is something I think that we have said many, many times. What's going to happen Let's go all the way back to the beginning of the course. What's going to happen when the ratio of positives to negatives fall below 5-1? When the ratio of positives to negatives fall below 5-1, what's one of the dangers? What is the thing that we have to be concerned about? If you have less than a 5-1 ratio. Now, of course, this is not set in concrete. It's not to say that, 4-1, but as a general rule, somebody came up with this formula. Mm-hmm. But what's going to happen when the ratio falls below 5-1? What's going to happen, say, for example, if for every 3 positive, there's a negative? What kind of negative impact is that going to have? How's it going to change one's perception of the marriage? Okay, now let's get this. Let's get this concept. This is very, very important. This is very basic. Now, if you think in terms of a balance sheet, you think in terms of a balance. You think, well, every bad deed is going to be canceled out by one good deed. In other words, I do something negative and I just do something positive and everything's okay. But is that true? No. That's not enough positive for that one negative. Now, what's going to happen if you have 2 positives for every 1 negative? There's still going to be a general perception that the marriage is negative.
That's right.
Okay, so here's the whole point. When the ratio falls below 5-1 of positives to negatives, the marriage is perceived as being negative. And then how's that going to affect when you begin to perceive your marriage as being negative? How's that going to affect you?
Negatively.
Well, the way that it's going to affect you is that you're going to start looking for the negative. You're going to focus on the negative. In other words, if you have a general negative feeling about your marriage, you're going to be looking for negative things that are going to support your contention that the marriage is going downhill.
That's right.
Okay? So, we want to help couples reduce negatives and to emphasize the positives. Decrease the negatives, increase the positives. Let me give you 2 basic scriptures that will give us a scriptural foundation for cognitive therapy. The first is Proverbs 23:7. It says, as a man thinketh, so is he in his heart. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. Out of the abundance of the heart comes forth evil deeds or good deeds, right? Mm-hmm. Now, what's going to determine the condition of that heart? It's going to be the way you think.
That's right.
As a man thinketh, so is he in his heart. If you think good thoughts, if you think positive things, then there are going to be positive actions and positive words are going to come out of your heart.
Sure.
All right, the second scripture is found in Philippians 4:8. This is very basic scripture, and I want to read it from King James. Philippians 4:8. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of a good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things.
Right.
Now, what is the scripture telling us to think on?
Positive things.
Okay. Think on these things. Think on all of these positives. And as a man thinketh, so is he in his heart. All right. Another thing that we can do to help reduce negative thinking is to, again, make partners aware of their negativity. And that can be done through bringing awareness to the couple by interrupting their patterns and discussing them. In other words, in the counseling session, you can take note of the interactions and interrupt. Okay, the first intervention number 1, this is an exercise, an intervention that can be used to help increase spouses' awareness of their selective attention to negative behavior. Again, attention to negative behavior, selective attention to negative behavior is when you just zero in on the negative, you select the negative at the exclusion of considering anything else. So this intervention has to do with the awareness, increasing awareness of selective attention and negative behavior. Okay, again, here you can interrupt ongoing negative interactions and coach spouses to identify the sequence. For homework, request that partners keep logs of marital interactions. Now, this is very important. You may want to make a note of this. Intervention number one is to have the couple, as a homework assignment, to keep a log of marital interactions. You know, sometimes if someone says, you know, that you are a very negative person, and you say, what do you base it on? Mm-hmm. It would be more accurate if you were able to have a log of specific interactions. And this is not intended for, say, for me as a husband to keep up with all the negative interactions with my wife. And I guess there have been times I've been tempted to do that. Mm-hmm. I've been tempted to prove to her, you know, that certain things. But it's not right for me to keep a log on what she says or does. By the same token, it's not right for her to keep a log on what I say.
Sure.
But if the two of you are seeking to improve your marital interaction to reduce the negative, then you agree that each of you are going to keep a log on your marital interactions and to take note as to whether they're positive or negative. Now, after you keep a log of the negative and positive interaction, then you write out what you feel. What are your feelings as they relate to these interactions? During treatment, again, we're talking about increasing the spouse's awareness of selective attention to negative cognition. During the session, you can look for sudden shifts in emotion or behavior. What would be an example of that? You look for sudden shifts in emotion or behavior that can give you a cue that can lead you to inquire about what one is thinking. See, we're trying to bring awareness. So you pick up on these little cues. You might say, you may see the wife kind of wrinkle up her forehead, or the husband, or kind of, you know, got a little twitch or a little show of displeasure. Mm-hmm. And you may say, I noticed that you reacted in a certain way. Now, what were you thinking? See, what were your thoughts about? Mm-hmm. What was just said? And again, you know, sometimes we make these little movements and not even be aware of them.
That's true.
Sometimes you can frown and not even be aware of it. And so when you pick up this little cue, you can call their attention to it and say, now what were you thinking? I noticed that you reacted there. And I'm just wondering, what were you thinking? That is just a way of drawing attention. Now again, if you're not specifically working on this particular aspect that you've agreed on, a person may resent you asking what they were thinking.
That's right.
But you've agreed on the fact that you need to be made aware. All right, the second intervention is a means of monitoring. Means of monitoring negative thoughts. And you do this for a week. You monitor negative thoughts for a week. And this is one thing you can do. You can have them to take their page or their log and divide it into three columns. Mm-hmm. The first column would be
the action or the event. Negative thoughts and outcomes. And I guess outcomes there would be feelings. Y'all help me here. Mm-hmm. Now think back some event that you may want to take note of during the week that you want to record, and then to write down your negative thoughts and then the outcome. What could be an example? The husband comes in 11 o'clock. Supposed to be home at 6.
Trouble.
Your negative thoughts are, oh no, he's back to his old tricks. He's out drinking.
Oh, yeah.
He's not, you know, that can be a trigger for, and of course, let's see, and then the outcome, of course, would be, what could be an outcome of such thoughts, of that particular event, and the thoughts that you have about that, what could be an outcome, or what would be the resulting, say, emotion or feeling?
Anger.
Anger.
Resentment.
Resentment. What would be maybe a big emotion?
What?
Fear.
Fear. Okay.
Yeah, it could be fear, right?
Yep.
Okay. So this will give you an example as you keep a log of events that will lead to a particular negative thought, and then to record your feelings or the outcome. Now, again, intervention two is monitoring. This is just the means to monitor your negative thoughts. Now, intervention three is changing negative thoughts. Do you see the difference? I mean, you have to monitor in order to become aware before you can go about changing negative thoughts. See, all of this coming under intervention of cognition.
Yeah.
Cognition, the way you think, the way you perceive, your expectations, your assumptions about your marriage could be a very definite area of problems.
Sure.
Okay? There are three steps that are recommended or that are suggested. And the first is to present the rationale. And of course, the rationale here of changing a person's negative thoughts is that, of course, the thoughts that we have will determine how we feel. The same event can lead to different behaviors depending on how we think. Mm-hmm. And so we present that rationale, and then we go through the monitoring thing. And then step number three, describe briefly three strategies for making thoughts more positive. And a lot of this, of course, is repeat, but, you know, that reinforces, I think, some of the basic concepts. And the first is to think about the positive instead of the negative. What if you had some, well, this could be even an obsession. I don't know. I do have some obsessive thoughts, or maybe let me put it this way, some obsessive mental activities, and one would be, I can go to bed at night with a song just going over and over, mm-hmm. just like a record player, just like a broken record, and I can wake up in the middle of the night and that song is still playing. I can get up in the morning, it's still playing. I don't know if anybody else has ever had that. Let me tell you a little humorous story, in a way, and I think I've certainly changed my thoughts and opinions over the years. When I first got saved as a teenager, I was taught that you didn't listen to anything that wasn't Christian music. I still think you ought to be selective,
yeah.
But because you listen to secular music is not evil.
Yeah. That's right.
And there's some excellent secular music. Again, it all depends on whether it's wholesome.
Yes.
But I remember growing up, when I first got saved as a teenager, I guess my family listened from time to time. The only radio station that they could pick up was a country music station. And after I got saved, I would get these obsessive patterns going in my mind, these country songs, and it would torment me. I mean, I would actually think I was on my way to hell, you know, because I'm obsessed with these evil songs. And of course, what we do oftentimes even there is we're not even aware of it. I mean, it's still playing, but we not be aware of it. And what I would seek to do would be to try to start another song in my head. But you know what I found out about that? Is that you can get obsessive replaying of a Christian song and can drive you crazy. I mean, honestly, when I say it drive you crazy, it's because of that obsession of just that, continuously repeating. My aunt, who's about 80 years old now, is in pretty good health, I would guess. Still has a wonderful sense of humor. But about 10 years ago, she said she started hearing the most beautiful music in her head. She said it was the most heavenly music that she had ever heard. And said the strange thing is that many of the songs that were being played in her head were songs that she remembered hearing as a little girl, church songs. And she's really a very humorous person anyway, and she goes to this Baptist church. She claims she's a Baptist Costal or something, you know. She goes to this Baptist church, but she makes it very clear to them, you know, she doesn't believe certain Baptist doctrine, but everybody loves her because she does have this good sense of humor. And she said this, that when all this beautiful music was going on in her head, that she got so bored with some of the dry, lifeless singing in the church that she just said to herself, I think I'll just go on home and listen to this good music. Well, the bottom line is it turned out that she had a brain tumor, and I have no idea how this triggered it. I have no idea how that worked. But because of this obsession, she went to the doctor and found out she had a brain tumor. Well, it's not insinuating that if you have a song going over and over in your mind that you have a brain tumor, but it does indicate perhaps that you do have some difficulties with obsessions, obsessional thinking. But the first thing that you would do in being able to change any thoughts would be to be aware of it, and you do that through monitoring. And I think this is so very good. This is good. Again, let me give you those three strategies for making thoughts more positive. You think about the positive instead of the negative. You make an actual attempt, an exerted effort to substitute positive for negatives. And this is very, very good. Think about how to solve the problem instead of elaborating the problem. Have you ever heard a statement that God wants us to be a part of the solution and instead of a part of the problem? You ever heard that statement? Have you ever heard the statement that some people pray the problem instead of praying the solution? How would you go about praying the solution rather than praying the problem? What would be the difference? What would be the difference in praying the problem and praying the solution?
Praying the solution for me would be praying the will of God.
Okay. What is the will of God?
According to the word of God.
What the word of God said. So one way you can pray the solution is to confess what the Word of God says.
Exactly right.
See, that's taking the positive. On the other hand, praying the problem would be, oh God, you know how much I'm hurting. You know what my need is. You know how much I'm hurting. Well, that's all true. And I think that God certainly has mercy on us. But I think it's a good practice that we begin to look for solutions instead of zeroing in on the problem. We want to be a part of the solution instead of being a part of the problem. And we certainly want to be able, again, to change our attitudes, change the way you look, change the way you look at the world.
That's right.
Look for the best in other people. Nancy's mother was a very positive person. She would be very complimentary of people. And one day, tell that story, Nancy, about... Yeah, tell that story. I think you can tell it better than I.
Well, Mother always saw the good in people instead of the bad. And so we had this one little old guy that lived in our small town that was a real busybody. He'd go from one church to another and he'd say, well, they had so many today, or they had so many today, or did you hear this or that? And, you know, we were talking around the house about old Joe, you know, him just going around busybodying. And she said, well, one thing you can say about old Joe is he can whistle good.
Oh, yeah, he can whistle good. I guess what that's saying is, I can't really think of anything else as good, but at least she did think of something that's good. Okay, intervention number 4 is keeping a journal of marital improvement. Keeping a journal of marital improvement. In the beginning, in the initial assessment time, one of the things that the counselor is seeking to discover about the marriage is, first of all, you know, what their perception is, what do they perceive as being the problem, how would you know if your marriage were improved? In other words, if your marriage were improved, what would be different? Now, what can happen over the course of counseling is that a person may not really recognize that there have been some successes. They may not believe that there have been progress made. And so if you keep a journal of marital improvement, then that can certainly change your thinking, your feeling about your perception of the marriage. So you write over a month in a journal describing the ways that your marriage has changed for the better and describing your feelings about those changes. Mm-hmm. Write how your marriage has changed for the better and write your feelings concerning those changes. Do not record complaints about the marriage. This is not the place to record complaints about the marriage. You record the positives. You record the improvement. Then intervention number 5, a homework assignment, have partners change negative thinking. Now, it sounds like a lot of this is repeat. Let's go back and see the difference. Intervention number 2, monitor negative thoughts. Intervention number 3, change each partner's negative thoughts. Journal of marital improvement, have partners change negative thinking. Well, it almost sounds like, okay, so that may very well be very similar to intervention 3. It very well can be, but it just so happens this is a specific homework assignment. A specific homework assignment. Now, here's what you are asking the counselees to do. You're asking them to add 2 more columns. So I suppose that this way. All right. Your event, negative thoughts, feelings, actions, results. Okay, now the event again can be the husband comes in late.
Well, he'd been out with someone.
Somebody else.
You feel rejected. You feel angry. You may be fearful. And then you record your action. What could be an action that could be taken? What can be an action that can be taken? Now, let's assume that this is faulty thinking that really has no basis, okay? Mm-hmm. So what action can you take? What action can you take to help you to deal with these negative thoughts and these feelings?
Mm-hmm. Try to find out the truth and focus on the positive.
Let's change the tape and then we'll continue. We're about to run out of tape. We'll repeat what you just said and speak up louder so that okay. Pick it up on the microphone here. Okay, the husband comes in at 11 o'clock. You think, well, he's up to no good. You feel angry. You're fearful. What are some possible actions that can help you to look at it differently and to have a different result?
Is try to come down and find out from your husband the reason why he was late.
Okay, don't jump to conclusions.
Yeah, don't jump to conclusion.
Yeah. All right, rethink it, give him the benefit of the doubt.
Exactly.
Maybe he comes up with a good explanation. Mm-hmm. And what would be the result, say, of that particular action?
You feel better.
Feel better, and... You remember one of the things that we said early in the session, that when you have irrational thoughts, and what you seek to do is to bring evidence that will either support or that will refute those particular thoughts. Now, I guess we want to be a detective or hire a detective. That's not really the basis for a good, strong marriage. Usually when you get to that point, you've already given up. You're looking for evidence to bring to court. But if you say, for example, you're looking for evidence, I think probably enough evidence would be to, you know, give him the benefit of the doubt if he comes up with some reasonable explanation. And then, of course, if he comes up with some kind of contradiction or something that you know is not the truth, or if it's verified otherwise, then I would suppose that the results would not be so positive.
Yes, sir. You know.
Okay, so that would be an example of intervention number 5. Okay, could you give me a glass of water? Another aspect of cognition is the attribution of blame. Attribution of blame. This is attributing the blame. Who do you attribute the blame to? Most usually people will attribute the blame to who?
To their husband.
Well, if you're the wife.
Oh.
Okay. Most usually one will attribute the blame to the other.
Yes.
Okay. When the marriage partners are in conflict, each sees the other's behavior. You cannot see your own. You see the other.
True.
And you're likely to explain your own behavior being due to what the spouse has done to you. You blame the spouse for the marriage difficulties. Mm-hmm. If you hadn't have done this, or if you had done this. Bishop says that we have a tendency to want others to judge us on the basis of our intentions. But we have a tendency to blame others, or we want to be judged on the basis of our intentions, but we want to judge others based on their behavior. In other words, if we behave in a wrong way, we want others to judge us according to what our intent was, but we don't give people the same benefit of the doubt. But oftentimes we will be quick to judge them based on their behavior rather and their intent. Okay. Empathy is the antidote to the poison of blaming. Empathy.
Right.
This is good.
Mm-hmm.
If partners can see things through the spouse's eyes, then the partners will be less likely to blame the spouse for the problem and will be more likely to take personal responsibility for improving the marriage. So if, say for example, if I, as a husband, am attributing blame to my wife, the counselor then tries to help me to see the situation through my wife's eyes, which is empathy. And thereby, if I can see the situation through my wife's eyes or attempt to do so, I may very well see it differently. And then that may lead me to be willing to take more responsibility for the particular action. And one way that we can encourage empathy is by dramatizing that each problem has multiple sides. To drive home the point that there's not just one way of looking at things. That everybody has a right to their own opinion. Everybody has a right to their perception. And if you can understand that, that your wife or your husband has as much right to their perception and their thoughts or their view as you, then that very well can help you to empathize. You want to help partners to respond with acceptance rather than blame. There's a little formula that is given. I don't know what page it's on, but this is pain plus accusation equals marital discord. Yep. You found that?
Yes, sir. Page 206.
Page 206. Pain plus accusation equals marital discord. Pain, of course, can be a negative experience. It can be something that can bring you grief. But when you then point the finger, accuse, then that can lead to marital discord. But pain minus the accusation equals acceptance. Okay, the next subsection is changing negative expectations about the marriage. Troubled marriages are plagued by expectations of a dismal future. And then, of course, when you begin to perceive the negative, you devalue the other, keep the marriage in an unloving state. And one way to break this cycle is to say to the couple, can you recall a time when your marriage was going in a positive direction? Now, what would happen if you behaved that way again? Could you change things to be more like they were before? And what would you have to do differently to get the marriage happy again? You know, we'll talk about this, a little bit later on. At some point in time, we will. But I think that one of the things that, in fact, this is, I think one of the things that we brought up under intimacy is that if you encourage a couple to re-romance each other, in fact, this is the counsel that I often give, say when the love is gone, when the romance is gone, and say, for example, the wife has become so disillusioned, so discouraged, then I say something like this to the husband. You remember what you did to woo her in the beginning. You remember what you did to win her. Then perhaps you may want to think in terms of going back and doing some of the same things now as you did then, because what won her in the beginning might very well re-win her.
That's right.
Changing negative assumptions about the marriage. Let me give you 10 faulty assumptions. And they're in your book there. And then one of the things you want to do is when you point out these assumptions, say for example, if you identify these specific faulty assumptions as being true in the couple's situation, you want to then take a look at what are the consequences of those faulty assumptions. Let's look at these 10 assumptions here. To demonstrate love, my mate must tell me he or she loves me several times daily. Is that a reasonable assumption?
No.
No. Is it necessary to tell your husband or your wife every day that you love them? Okay.
It would be nice.
Yeah, it would be good. It could be helpful. But is it necessary? I mean, can you assume that if your husband doesn't tell you every single day that he loves you, that that he doesn't love me? In other words, he's got to tell me every day. Yeah, and I think we all like to hear it. Do I kiss my wife every day when I leave? No. Do I kiss her every night when I come in? No. Should I? Probably. Yeah. And it would. And I think sometimes we probably take things for granted. We'll in the next lesson we'll be talking about commitment. And I think sometimes we can overplay, or we can take commitment for granted. Commitment goes a long way. Commitment can cover a lot of sins. It may not mean that you have a fulfilling marriage, but it does mean that you can learn to coexist, or you can learn to stay together. And that's not really the ideal. And some people do learn how to live with one another. They learn how to just to stay together and no real problems, but no real fulfillment. Okay, the second common faulty assumption is, if I don't feel romantic with my partner, it means we aren't in love any longer. Well, then it gets back to, what do you define as love?
That's right.
Romance may be a particular aspect of love, but you can't say if there's no romance there, there's no love. A third assumption, my partner should meet all my needs, especially all my needs for intimacy. And so you think, well, yeah, my partner should be the supply of all my intimacy. But what could be some other sources of intimacy? What could be some other?
Help her in the house. Help her do some work around the house.
Well, then if you're saying that you're depending on your spouse to provide that, my question is, how can you experience intimacy outside of your spouse? Is there a right? What does intimacy mean? Does that mean that you're sexually involved? No, not necessarily. No. It's having a connection on a deeper level. It's having a meaningful bond or a meaningful conversation. And what would be a source of intimacy outside of your marriage?
Relationship with God.
Well, yeah, sure. And that's where it all begins. And
yeah.
And we're going to be emphasizing that a great deal in the next lesson. But what about a good friend? What about a good friend of the same sex? What do you think about having, quote, a good friend of the opposite sex when you're married?
Casual.
And when you say good friend, yeah. I hear people say, well, you know, she's my good friend. And my question is, why do you have to have a female other than your wife as your good friend that would exclude your wife? Okay. The need for intimacy could be the relationship you have with your children. And that's not to be a substitute. That's not to take the place of, but it can be a supplemental. It could be a fellowship, just like the ladies are meeting here tonight. Wouldn't that be a source of intimacy? Yeah. I mean, if there's a close fellowship, yeah. What about having intimacy with your pet? Can they meet a particular emotional need in your life?
I never had that.
If you love pets, they sure could.
Well, my son had a dog that had puppies just recently, and I've never been a great animal lover. I remember really loving animals when I was small, And I think there are several reasons why that I do not choose to become emotionally attached is because I did have some painful experiences as a child in losing a puppy and losing a little cat. And also, I've seen, well, the big thing with me is the responsibility that comes with it. I think I'm at a point in time in my life that I don't need a pet, you know, to fulfill something in my life. Some people do. And I said in a joking way, I said, you know, wonder what it is about a person who needs a pet to fill that gap in their life. And I suppose you don't get the proper amount of attention and love from your spouse. Maybe you can find it with your dog or your cat. But we had these little puppies, and I had to say I fell in love with them. And we came to the place that we couldn't keep them. We had seven little puppies, and I mean, they were just absolutely adorable. It broke my heart, you know, when we had to give them away. But, and again, there, I guess my big thing is I don't want to be tied down.
Yeah.
If you go out of town, you got to get somebody to take care of it. Mm-hmm. I don't like pets in the house, and if you don't, in the city, you have a hard time keeping outside. So I guess there are a lot of rational thinking that goes into my particular feeling. Okay, number four, my partner should support all my ideas. Mm-hmm. Is that a fair assumption?
No.
They should be supportive of you, but it doesn't necessarily mean they have to be supportive of your ideas. It certainly means that your wife ought to be able to give you honest feedback. And I guess you can come to the conclusion that if that idea is really important to you, I'll support you in it. But by the same token, I think that you should respect a different opinion on the matter. Number five, when I've had a bad day, my mate should be able to sense it and should do something to cheer me up without my having to tell him or her. And I say, please don't get into mind reading. Don't get into mental telepathy. If you need something, request it. Now, you may pick up there's something going on. You know, sometimes I'll say to Nancy, is everything okay? She'll say the same thing to me. I think that one of the things that she and I both have come to understand is that sometimes when we're having, quote, a bad day, or if we're not real talkative, it doesn't mean that we're have any ought against one another, and I guess that needs to be communicated. I think there were times that Nancy thought I was personalizing it and taking it out on her. And that all becomes a part of communication. As John Gray says in Men from Mars and Women from Venus, that men have to go into their caves, you know, when they're dealing with a bad situation. They have to kind of pull back. And the husband needs to inform the wife that he's going into his cave, and he needs to communicate to her that I'm coming out, and communicate to her that it's not your fault.
That's right.
Okay. Number six, my spouse should not expect me to be courteous and polite. That's what marriage is all about, being yourself and not having to put on some show. Well, I don't believe you need to put on a show, and I think that we should be able to be ourselves, mm-hmm. but there's no excuse not to be courteous and polite.
True.
And there's really no justification to say that's the way I am. This is the way I am, this way my daddy was, and you can't expect me to be any different. Okay, 5, 6, 7. My partner should be able to know how to stimulate me when we're making love. I shouldn't have to tell him or her what to do and when to do it. Now, we're not going to get into any explicit sex therapy here, but again, even in the intimacy and sexual intimacy in particular, communication is very important. Again, there you don't assume anything, and you do not depend on mind reading or mental telepathy. My mate and I should do almost everything as a couple if we are to maintain a happy marriage. Is that a fair assumption?
Mm-mm.
No. I think there's something wrong if you don't do a significant amount of things together, but by the same token, everybody needs to have their own space. Okay, I should be able to keep my partner from ever getting unhappy. Now, what's so faulty about that? What's wrong?
You can't. You ain't God.
Well, first of all, you're not responsible for anybody else's happiness. My wife can't make me happy, and I can't make her happy. Now, she may do things that may cause me to respond with happiness, but again, happiness is an inside job.
Yep.
I know some people who have gone through a very difficult time, say through the loss of a spouse, but I've seen also some of these people had some of the same problems and same issues before they lost their spouse. So the spouse was not the source of happiness, nor was the loss of the spouse the source of unhappiness. And number 10, my partner and I should never argue or disagree if our marriage is good. Should never argue or disagree. Well, there's a way to argue in the right way, or there's a right way to disagree.
Yes.
You can agree to disagree. You can agree to be agreeable. Well, that's all the time we have for this lesson. I think that probably what I'll do is we do have a little bit more in this lesson, and we'll pick back up on the end of this in our next lesson. And so that's all for this particular lesson. God bless, and we'll see you the next time.